Welcome to MCN. So what's it like to go flat out on the new 2021 Suzuki Hayabusa? Suffice it to say that the new Busa has always been synonymous with speed. And it's why that when we did a little walk around video earlier in the year of the Busa, it got such a lot of interest. I think it had something like a million views in the first week, which was absolutely unbelievable. And it really shows what an icon the Hayabusa still is today and how much interest there is for it. So I won't waste too much of your time telling you exactly about what makes the new Busa tick, because you can check out our other video where we go into some deep detail. But suffice it to say that essentially it's the same bike as before, with different styling, more electronics, and loads of engine mods that add up to, well, less power and less torque. But Suzuki claim more grunt in the mid-range and more acceleration. And that's really what we wanted to put to the test. So we got to ride the new Busa at its UK launch in Sywell Aerodrome in Northampton. I think the launch was going to be riding from Monaco to Barcelona. So it's a little bit different, but more real world, I'd say. Sitting there on the Busa at the start of a 0.8 of a mile runway, it's very familiar to anyone who's owned a Busa since 1999. It's got the very same low riding position. It's long and low. There's a lot of bike in front of you, a lot of bike behind you. The clocks are very, very familiar. It's still got the analog clocks. And the way the engine revs sounds very, very similar as well. It's still the same 1340cc inline four. It's quite angry, but quite damped at the same time. Just sounds like a powerhouse of an engine waiting to explode. The only differences you'll see on the clock is before the Suzuki went up to 220 mile an hour, the original Busa, but now it's 180, so a little bit more real world. And the bars are now slightly closer to you, 12 mil closer. But to be honest, it doesn't make that much difference. You wouldn't really know unless you're riding the two back to back. One thing that is different is that on the start, you can dial in launch control. So it's got three stage launch control, which are just part of its big new electronics package. So you can set it at 3,700 RPM, 6,000 RPM, or 8,000 RPM. And basically what that does is, even if you flat out, it holds the revs. It's a rev limiter. So all you need to worry about is just letting out the clutch. You've still got to let it out smoothly. You can't just dump it. But the reality is you can pull away a lot faster the old fashioned manual way, just with your left hand and your right wrist. So the idea of us running down the runway was to get some performance figures. So we strapped a GPS onto the bike and off we went. But I'm going to make my excuses first. So number one, I never do performance testing at MCN. I just ride the bikes. Do lots of track testing. I race a lot as well. But in terms of actual performance testing, that is quite a skill. And we normally have one of our guys, Bruce Dunn, does all our performance testing. And he's used to getting the most out of the bike on acceleration, knows exactly what to do. So that's my first excuse. My second one is the fact that I've never used this particular GPS before, so I never knew if it's even going to work. We only got two goes at it. Because it was the end of the day when I did my speed testing. And also I never knew where to brake at the end of the runway. So the runway is 0.8 of a mile, and that's where the runway finishes and the grass starts. So really, if you look at your braking marker, which is probably going to be about 300 yards before the end, you've probably only got about half a mile of performance testing. So all my excuses are at the ready. So without launch control, my technique of getting a bike away fast on the line, and it's Bruce's as well, is just to get the clutch out as soon as you can. So off the start, first gear, let the clutch out. As soon as it's out, then you can pin it. and suddenly the Busa is vicious. The acceleration is incredible, and it kind of makes a mockery of those that have criticized the Busa for being down on power and down on torque online. You know the ones. So power is down from 194 bhp to 187, and torque is down 3 pound-foot, which on paper sounds a lot, but in reality 180 whatever horsepower is an immense amount, and the Busa just absolutely pins you back in the seat in first gear, and the acceleration is so strong that it's hard to get over the front wheel to control the wheelie. So it's worth saying now that we turned all the rider aids off as well, so the Busa's got traction control, wheelie control, all the controls, but they all get in the way when you actually want to ride it fast. So in first gear, it's just a question of hanging on for dear life. And then once you hook second, the new gearbox, fantastic by the way, as is the quick shifter. Once you're in second, everything settles down, and then the Busa just goes like a bullet train. And the acceleration is just trying to rip your face off as you're accelerating through the gears, through about 11,000 RPMs, the red line. But what's really incredible about the Busa is in the serene surroundings of an airfield where there's no impression of speed, so it doesn't actually feel that fast on an airfield, all you're really looking at is the clocks. And what is unbelievable is how fast the speedo needle goes around the dial. So it goes to 100 mile an hour, 12 o'clock, like poof, straight away. And it just keeps accelerating rounds 120, 130, 140, like, wow, it's unbelievable. It's like it's a taco. And that's really where the Busa scores against even the 200 bhp superbike. It's the way it just, the grunt just pushes you through the gears at very, very high speed. It's just relentless. You know, there's no replacement for displacement, as they say. And, you know, having all those CCs working for you really shoots the Busa down that runway. With all that extra torque, Suzuki reckon it's got more oomph between 4 and 6,000 RPM. Not only does it fire you down the runway pretty damn quick, it's fantastic on the road. So on the road, it's an engine. It's just so relaxed all the time. It's just got huge reserves of smooth, creamy power. I know that description has been used 1,000 times about a Busa, but it's true. All you need to do is just leave it in top gear and you just drive it anywhere. It's just so effortless. It's just so different from anything. It is fantastic. And it's got so much oomph. It would make a Kawasaki H2SX feel like a two-stroke by comparison. And that extra grunt it's got between 4 and 6,000 RPM in top gear is actually 100 mile an hour. So you get an idea of just how much of a grunt fest it is riding the new Busa on the road. So back to the airfield. We're kind of steaming down that runway at top speed. And the thing about the Busa, it's the chassis is unchanged. It's got the same frame, the same swing arm. And that's a good thing because it is just so stable. If the cruise control would let you ride it flat out, it doesn't, it stops at 124 mile an hour. But if it let you go flat out on cruise control, you could just ride with your hands behind your back and the bike would just be unwaveringly stable. It is just incredible how stable it is. And again, on the road, that stability just lets you demolish aeros just so easily. And then the stability of the bike working with the grunt of the engine, it's beautiful. Suzuki have only really changed the suspension internals. The externals are still the same, still got the same upside down forks and shock. But now the ride quality is so plush, you'd swear it's got O-lins. And the way it just, you know, absolutely irons out any bumps in the road just makes the Suzuki feel, you know, like you're running on velvet all the time. So it's really stable. Ride quality is absolutely beautiful and you've got all of that grunt. And when you're riding on the road and enjoying its performance, what is really surprising is how sporty the Busa's riding position is. So back in the day, it was always kind of used as the grand tourer, the sports tourer. But nowadays, when you've got adventure bikes and full-on tourers that do a very similar thing, the Busa feels quite extreme, more extreme than a lot of sports bikes. So because the seat's so low and the pegs are so high, tall riders are going to get crushed knees. And even though the bars are closer to the rider, it's still really, really wristy. So after a few hours, it's quite painful to ride. But it's got cruise control. So on a long journey, that's really good for being able to shake your right wrist off the bar. So on the runway, you know, it's really, really stable. On the road, it's a little bit slow steering, should we say. It's a big, long, heavy bike. It's 264 kilos, which is 2 kilos less than it used to be. So it's still a very, very heavy bike. So it doesn't like to be rushed. You can't grab it by the scruff of the neck and flick it through corners. But if you take your time with it and kind of guide it through a back road, it's actually really, really capable and really, really quick. The other good thing about it is it's got new Bridgestone S22 tyres on, which for an original equipment tyre is very, very good. The only thing I'd say about it is it's not Bridgestone's fault, but the rear tyre is an old style 50 profile, whereas modern bikes have got 190 55s, which are more balloon shape. And I think a more modern looking tyre would just make the Busa look a little bit nicer. So now we're reaching the end of the runway. That green bit at the end's coming up really, really quick. And it's time to brake. So Suzuki have put bigger brake discs on them, 10 mil bigger. They're up to 320 mil. And you've also got Brembo Stylomer calipers. So the braking hardware is fantastic. Its only real disadvantage is the ABS. And we see that all the time on Japanese bikes now. The ABS is set really, really conservatively. So it will intrude way before it really needs to in the quest for safety, really, rather than performance. So the brakes are a really, really big improvement on the old Busa, and that was one of its big, big Achilles heels. But the braking power is better, and on the road is fine. And also using a bit of rear brake really helps slow down a long, low, heavy bike. So you never got any issue on the road, but when you're doing an emergency stop at the end of a runway, you kind of feel their limitations. So what you feel with brake-by-wire systems like this through the lever is you pulling on a rubber bung. It's not actually you pushing the pistons in the calipers, because that's all done by the ABS pump under the seat. So when you brake, you get this sensation that the brake pressure doesn't match the rate you're slowing down, which on the runway is fine, because I was a bit of a wuss and braked early, so I'd reach the end and get home in time for tea. So the braking power is okay, but it's not brilliant. So because you're sort of, hasn't got a lot of feel because of the way the system's set up. And when you brake hard, the hazards flash as well, like a lot of modern bikes do now. But we managed to stop. So when we got back to MCN Towers and downloaded all the data, which actually worked, which was good, I saw that the figures weren't brilliant, which is down to me. So I managed a 0-60 in 3.08 seconds. And with a bit more practice, or with a Bruce Dunn at the helm, I reckon you could get down into the late twos quite easily. Did a quarter mile in 10.36 seconds. At 145.9 mile an hour, which is good, but again with practice, I reckon I could easily get down into the nines. So despite me being a little bit rubbish at performance testing, those figures are better than any superbike we've ever tested, even in the hands of our racing stig Bruce Dunn. It's also better than any super naked we've tested as well, which just goes to show how good and how capable the Busa is, even in the hands of an idiot. The roll on times, 40 to 80 mile an hour, was dispensed in just 5.37 seconds. And braking from 70 mile an hour to standstill wasn't great because of the ABS, and it did it in 54.4 meters. Now that's probably 5, 6, 7 meters worse than a really good bike on the brakes, but it's actually 1 meter sooner than a Yamaha R1M. But that's not saying a lot, because that's probably got one of the worst ABS, the most intrusive ABS setups of any sports bike. Talking of stats, Suzuki claim just 42 mpg, which is around 148 miles to the fuel light, more or less. But that's taking it easy. If you were to ride the Busa properly, it would do a lot less, which for a bike with 20 litre tank isn't great. But you can blame Euro 5 for that. So what all of this proves is that even though I'm not a seasoned performance tester, the Busa is still flipping rapid. And to extract the speed it's capable of is very easy. You know, it's still such a sense of occasion to ride it, and it's still just such a mad bike that the fact it still exists, you've really got to take your hat off to Suzuki. You know, it hasn't really moved the game on. If you want to do big distances at speed, nowadays there's a lot better bikes to choose from big adventure bikes to proper sports tourers. But does that really matter? I don't really think so. I think the Busa has got a special place in people's hearts just because of what it is. It's just a mad looking thing that is just fast beyond belief. And I think, you know, the little tweaks Suzuki have made to it have improved it with the electronic safety. I like the fact they've kept the clocks. I even love its bodywork. I was disappointed at the time, it didn't really look that different. But the more you look at it now, just the more you've got to just, you know, admire how crazy the Busa is. And it's still a bike that is an icon of speed. And I'm so glad we finally got to ride it. And it's a fantastic thing.